So as Raul said, my name is Jeff Sanders. I'm a senior escalation engineer and developer support. What that means is if you create a technical support case, especially in Windows Azure Mobile Services, it'll end up coming to me or somebody on my team. So I've been supporting and working with Azure Mobile Services before the preview, and I also trained up our team on how to work with mobile services and troubleshoot that. So as previously mentioned, this is going to be a little bit interactive, so this is your time, and I've tried to structure this in a way, to, given your feedback, that would be useful to you. So some of it may seem a little simple, but actually I'll drill into it a little bit deeper and show you some tips and tricks behind some of this stuff. So even if you've done this before, I'm hoping I can show you something that you haven't seen before and give you the tools to be able to effectively use and understand what mobile services will do for you. And so again, with that in mind, if there's something that confuses you or you're not following me, please feel free to interrupt, you know, hit the chat window up or unmute yourself and ask, and we will go from there. I might defer you to later if it's something that's I will be covering a little bit later, but you know, definitely this will be better for all of us if you ask questions, and the question you ask, somebody else may have in the back of their mind as well. So let's get going. There's not going to be very many slides, and I've already talked about this as well. So let's just jump into the basic architecture of a Windows Azure Mobile Services so everybody understands the basics of what Azure Mobile Service gives you. Very simply, on the left is a mobile device. So that could be your phone, it could be an iOS, Android, it could be a Windows Store application, or even a traditional Windows desktop application. And that desktop application talks to mobile services, which is this mysterious stuff that contains a website that we stand up for you, a database behind the scenes, and some configuration settings. And the interesting thing about that is by using this thing called REST and OData, it's just an open HTML or HTTP or HTTPS call that goes over the wire. It talks to the mobile service and gets data back. And that's kind of the premise of what I'll be showing you today, is how that actually works. Be aware that there's the browser-based configuration. I'll be using that almost exclusively today to talk about the service itself, but you also can get to the browser, or excuse me, the configuration through command line configuration as well, and that's documented up in your Azure portal, which again we'll be in quite a bit. And then finally there's Git integration, so you can do a lot with throwing your scripts up in, let's say if you had a UAT environment or something like that, or a testing environment that you wanted to be able to push these scripts to test something, you can actually integrate that with source control. I'll talk about that a little bit if we have some time, but that's fairly well documented as well. So I'm going to go ahead and just get started, and we're going to investigate some mobile services here. So we're talking about mobile services. If you haven't been to the portal yet, here I have a jillion different things going on in Windows Azure, but the mobile services is this one down to the left here. You see I have a bunch of them going on here, and we'll drill into some of these and see what's going on. An important troubleshooting step is if you're having troubles with your mobile service itself, let's take, for example, this Jeff Training mobile service here. One of the first things you can do is take a look at the URL that's off to your right and click on that to see if you get to it. And you'll see in this case it says mobile service is up and running, so that means at the very least that website, https://jefftraining.azure-mobile.net, is up and running. But what does that actually mean? So let's go back again to the portal. So when we create a mobile service for you, what we actually do is create this instance of a website, and we give it the name of the mobile service. So I know auth ID auth is going to be auth ID auth dot Azure mobile dash or Azure dash mobile.net. And I can use that information while I'm coding against this, but in general, that's the rule. We've created this mobile service with your reserve name, and we put it up in a public domain so you can reach it from anywhere. And then we've done some background configuration for you. So when you create a mobile service, let's open up Jeff Training. A couple things happen when you create this. First thing we do is we prompt you for a database, and we'll get into databases a little bit later. We're going to talk about some cool things you can do with views and be able to access data from different tables within your database. But we create a database for you or let you hook up to an existing Azure database. So again, in this architecture, we have this HVS website that we've stood up for you. And then we've created a database for you. So if you had nothing at all in your Azure portal, right after you created your mobile service, it will prompt you to create or connect to an existing SQL database. And again, this is an Azure database. One thing you want to pay attention to is make sure that your mobile service and your database is in the same location. For example, here's East US, it could be West US, it could be over in the Europe side of things. We are adding different locations. I had a question from a customer was asking about Western Europe or Eastern Europe, I can't remember which one of those, was not available for Windows Azure Mobile Services, but his database was. So keep in mind, these are separate elements. So we create a SQL Azure database for you. So it would be possible to put your Azure database in a location that is not where your server is. That's bad for obvious reasons. We have to start communicating within the same center. We'd have to cross through routers and get to the actual different location. So another good troubleshooting in Windows Azure Mobile Services, and let's go back to Jeff training again, is to see if the database is up. So maybe you can hit this URL, but you're getting some weird errors and you don't know what's going on. You could find out about your database, if you forgot, and have several like me, by going to your dashboard. And you'll see down here it lists the databases, J Sanders B. So by clicking on that, you can actually get to your database to see what's going on, set some configuration, but you can also go to design it. So if you can hit your database by hitting design your SQL database, and you can log in. And you can check out your particular tables associated to each of your mobile services. So this brings up another good point. When we create your SQL Azure mobile service, or your mobile service with a SQL Azure backend, you'll notice that we could have picked, let me go back here, we could have picked from several databases in here. Not only that, but each mobile service can connect to the same database. So I have a couple mobile services pointing to JSandersDB. And if I did the default to-do item sample, each of them get a to-do item table created, but they don't collide. You'll notice the Jay Sanders or the Jeff Training one, that has a totally different set of records than the auth records have in that mobile service. And you can see that. I backed out of it. Here we go. By the schema name. So the schema name, and we'll get to this a little bit later when we talk a little bit further about databases, is actually the name of your mobile service as well. So when I access my mobile service, Jeff Training, it's expecting to find a table called Jeff Training inside of the database that I specified. So you see, I have actually three mobile services pointing to the same database. I have one called Auth ID Auth, Jeff Training, and Jay Sanders Push Tutorial. Oh, and a fourth one, Scheduler Sample. So I want to pause just for a minute, make sure you are all clear on that relationship of the SQL database to the mobile service itself. And if you have any questions about that or something's unclear, please let's go ahead and zap it into the IM or just unmute yourself and ask the questions. So I'll give you all a minute. Okay, we'll proceed. So again, investigating the architecture of the system, I'm going to use a tool called Fiddler. If you're on a Mac OS, you can use something called Postman, which is available in Google Chrome, and it does very similar things to this. And matter of fact, you could also use Composer using Chrome, but you get a lot more powerful with something in Fiddler called the Composer. So I'm going to go through some basics of using Fiddler. When you first start it up, by default, I'm going to click in the bottom left-hand corner. You'll see it says Capturing. And any HTTP traffic that comes through in this case, I'm typing Microsoft.com. Whether I type it down here or actually hit it in a browser, it'll capture the HTTP and potentially HTTPS traffic. Now, there's some links to how to that tell you how to capture HTTPS traffic and intercept that, so I won't go over that here, but briefly, it's under the Tools Fiddler options, and you can configure HTTPS and capture and decrypt it here. You can also use this if you're developing a phone app. So anything on the Microsoft platform that'll go through our networking will be grabbed through Fiddler. So what I wanted to do is go through talking about architecture, relate that to Fiddler, and show how we call into the mobile service and do certain things. There's two ways to do that. One, you could actually create the app that you get by default when you create a new mobile service and just use Fiddler and intercept that traffic. But it's actually even easier than that with just a little bit of knowledge. And this is also a very handy troubleshooting step when you're dealing with your code. If you realize that the backend, the data, and that data flow goes over the wire as HTTPS or HTTP traffic, it's very easy to see what's going on from your application and verify certain things are working correctly. So again, we're going to stay with the Jeff Training application here. And again, that URL, the HTTPS Jeff Training Azure Mobile.net, I'm going to copy that. And I'm going to use something in Fiddler called Composer. So again, when you start Fiddler, you'll get some information over here, which is the traffic. And on the right are things you can use to manipulate or inspect the traffic. The Composer here is what we'll be talking about here. So I'm going to issue just a GET on Jeff Training Azure Mobile.net. And I'm going to get rid of these things because we don't need this. We'll just see what we get back in Fiddler on the left side. You see we get a 200, which means OK. If I double-click on it, it'll bring it up in the inspector. The top view is what I sent and is configurable as far as what I want to see, the headers or maybe the raw actual request. And the same thing in the bottom is the response. So I could see the text view. I could see a web view of it if I want by clicking on here, the headers, or the JSON, which we'll talk about very shortly. So one thing about the REST APIs, it's very simple, and it's sort of standard. There's this thing we call OData, which is used to do queries and access tables. And with a little knowledge about OData, we can go after the tables, and I know I have a to-do item, which is created by default if you want one. And I'm going to try to get that table. And if I go to Jeff Training Azure Mobile.net, tables to-do item here on the left and double-click on it, you see it returned to me some JSON. Now, when I clicked on it, the inspector actually knew that there was JSON data, and this is part of the OData protocol. And then automatically gave it to me in a friendly view. So I can see there's a bunch of objects. It says complete false, ID 6, and text data here. And this actually, of course, relates back to your SQL Azure database, which you can get through your mobile service. I'll show you this in the raw view as well. And so you can get an idea. This is actually what's coming back in HTTP traffic, or HTTPS in this case. So I'm going to grab one of these JSON objects that was returned. And again, using the Composer, Ryan had a good question. Does OData service apply any default limits to return records? Yes. By default, I believe it's 30 records. And the reason behind that is we're kind of gearing this towards mobile applications where you want to be grabbing your data in chunks at a time through something like a virtual view. And I actually have a blog entry on how to take advantage of that, which I'll give you some links to my blog. The other limits to OData are you can't do absolutely everything in OData that you can do with SQL. So writing complex queries and that sort of thing and joining tables, you're not going to be able to do that from here. But what I'll show you a little bit later on is you really don't want to do it here. You want to do it in your views or your back end so that your client is as simple as Fiddler. You're just throwing off these basic requests to get information or post information, and then your back-end scripting is actually taking care of massaging this data or giving you different views. So great question, Ryan. Thanks. Some will go back to Composer, and again, using this concept of REST and OData, in this table, what I want to do is I want to post a new record. And what this will do, if I get it right, somebody have a question? Okay. So what this will do is, if I do everything right, should introduce a new record into the table. So I'll change the text up a little bit. And we'll hit execute in Composer. You see we get a 201 result back, which is a success. It actually means created, as we see here down at the bottom. And it did insert the item. Now looking at this, there's something interesting. We get this location here where it says transport. And this corresponds to the actual data item in our mobile service. So let me copy this and I'll show you what I mean. So I'm going to copy that value. Oh, also let me show you the JSON of this. So when we create it, we'll click on the JSON. You'll see it does verify that here's what I set, and then it has this ID equals 16. So the ID is the key into our database. And again, by using this Composer, for that matter, you could actually issue this right from Internet Explorer command line or from the address bar. But we can get that to-do item the 16th, the index, whatever sitting at index 16 we'd execute. Again, double click on the left, and you see we return that record that we just inserted. So those are basic operations of how to get items and how to add items to the database. If there are any questions about this so far, is everybody fairly clear what's going on? Looks like Mike has a question, or Mark. Is this using web API in the background? So what's actually in the background is we're standing up a HTTPS web service, and interestingly enough, it's Node.js. And what we do is we get these requests, we process them through some possible scripting that you can do, and then pass it off to the SQL database in the background. Any other questions? Oh, great. Okay, great. Moving on. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the rest of these, but you can actually update your records through the patch. So I can update item 6, and I could set some, I could just change one of the attributes on that. And then finally, delete would delete it. So I'll show you delete. That's pretty straightforward. So that has our basic database CRUD operations. Let's hit delete, see if that succeeds. Interesting, I got an error. So let's take a look at troubleshooting mobile services a little bit more. Let's say if you had problems with your application and you were getting this weird error back, an exception, you couldn't figure out what's going on, you could capture that traffic with Fiddler, and then you could inspect it further by double-clicking on it. Now, even if you don't know too much about HTTP protocol, 401, it'll tell you here in the response header what's going on. So for some reason, you're unauthorized to hit this. We tried to delete a record. For some reason, it's restricted. So let's dig into this a little bit more. So my first step would have been to capture this traffic and see what's going on. Knowing that I got this 401, that points to something to do with authentication with my mobile service. So I'm going to go back to the dashboard, and let's take a look at Jeff Training. Let's go to the data tab. So you notice I have a couple of tables in Jeff Training. And what's kind of cool about mobile services is you can control the authentication on each table and on each operation individually. So we were hitting to-do item. Let's hit that. And you see all the way on the right, there's this permission setting. And you'll see here, on my table permissions, I said everyone can insert records. For the read permission, I said everyone can read it. But notice there's restriction here on update and delete. It says anybody with the application key. That's actually the default when you create a mobile service, is that it will allow you to, or it just sets up by default that you can't access this particular table unless you have the application key. You get that one of two places. when you create the application, or excuse me, the mobile service, you get this dashboard. By the way, to get to there, if you have this default dashboard view, for example, you click on this funny looking icon off to the left, and that's how you get back to here. You can get it by creating a new Windows Store app, and that'll give you the application key. You can get that information by hitting connect to an existing Windows Store app, and it's buried inside of here. But probably a better place is under your manage keys. You see right here it lists the application key. So I'm going to copy this. And if for some reason it ever gets shared to everybody, you can always regenerate a new one, like what I'm doing here today. And then you need a little bit of information about mobile services, and that's when you make the HTTP request. So again, we'll go back to composers, and we're going to try to delete this writer. This record, you have to add a special header, and we call the XZumo application. And again, this is documented as well, and it wants that application key that we just saw and gathered from the other side. So again, if I've done everything correctly, I should not get the 401 now because I have applications that for the permissions. And so unless I pass this application key, I should expect the 401. So let's execute and see if I did everything right. We get a 204 back. Might not know what that is. So if you click on it, it means no content, which just basically means we deleted it, so there's nothing left. So that delete succeeded. So with the knowledge that, let's say that, I have a question. yeah, Ryan. Yeah, some people don't get the status, HTTP status codes right, so we did our best to get it correct to begin with. So let's talk a little bit about the authentication. Now, this is a quiz, so pay attention. Let's say I captured this. Somebody, you've created this kick butt application, Windows Phone, Windows Store app, whatever it happens to be, and you're using the application key to secure your reads, writes, updates, and deletes. Can somebody tell me why using application key for security would be a bad idea? So Ryan said, all your base are belong to us. I am not sure what that means, but I'll share with you what it means. So remembering that this is just HTTPS or HTTP traffic, you can intercept it. All somebody would have to do is install your application, run it once, look at something that uses authentication, and they could steal your application key. And as you saw me do right here in Fiddler, they could write their own application to blast through your database, delete all your records, whatever they wanted to. So the question from everybody that's realized this at some point or another is like, well, what good is the application key? That's not really security. And the answer is that's absolutely correct. Never, ever, ever use the Zumo application key for security. So the next question is always, well, then why do you have it? And we really struggled with taking it out because it created a little bit of confusion to begin with. And it's been explained in the forum, so if you actually searched on this, you could probably figure it out by looking at the forums. But just so you hear it from me, the application key was created so that when I create a mobile service, and let's say I call my Super Oak Trees mobile service or something like that, somebody, and I'm developing that mobile service, it's a little clunky to have to implement user authentication or worry about trying to secure it from the outside world. If somebody could guess your, again, knowing that .azure-mobile.net is the end of your URL, somebody could potentially guess your URL for your mobile service and start goofing with your database on you while you're in development. Now, until you publish that, you can use the XZumo application key to secure this thing from anybody messing with you while you're in development, because nobody's going to guess that application key. If they want to use a brute force attack to do it, maybe they would, but they have way too much time on their hands. And if you're worried about it, you could go back to user authentication on this. So hopefully everybody understands XZumo application key has nothing really to do with security, except in the case where you've never installed this app anyplace else or never shared this information. So right now you guys could all hack my database because you know what my application key is. I'll make sure I regenerate it. So matter of fact, I'll show you how to do that right now. So to regenerate that application key, I don't think there's any reason you'd have to, because again, this should be development only. You'd simply go to manage keys for your mobile service, hit regenerate. And we'll do the demo effect. Let's see if I am correct. Oh, I can't delete. We can delete 15. Let's do that. So try to delete record 15, but we haven't changed that application key. We're going to hit execute. And again, you see we get that 401 because the application key is changed. Again, it's not a security measure. If that's not clear to everybody, please let me know. We'll talk a little bit more about other ways to secure things as we move along. But I just want to make sure you guys are 100% aware of this and the fact that it is not secure. We've seen some applications that are using this for security, which is scary. Not that everybody would be concerned with hacking into their mobile service necessarily, but they just weren't aware of it. Okay, so let's move on. Any questions, please let me know. Okay, let's talk a little bit about troubleshooting while we're in the dashboard still. There's a couple things that you can cause problems with the mobile service with. And we stand up this nice mobile service for you in the background, but unfortunately, as with any code, you can mess yourself up. And discovering what that is and correcting it quickly is fairly easy if you know a few steps. So when you're looking at your mobile service, again, we're still in Jeff training, and you go over to this logs tab. If you have any error logs, they'll show up here. There's a couple of ways that we can get things into this logs. The first way is if there's an error in your script and it's not caught, what'll happen is we'll actually reflect that log into here. So if you just write your script happy path thinking everything's going to succeed, and it does most of the time, then the only time you see a log in here is if something goes awry. And it'll show up in the log. And we'll generate some logs so you can see what's going on there. The other way you can get information in the logs is actually by writing to the log. So this is a great debugging tool. When you're writing scripts, which we'll talk about in just a minute, if you are trying to debug your script and can't figure out what's going on, this is a real great way to do it. I mean, it's just the old-fashioned printf type statements for you older programmers like me. You can actually write out where you are in the script itself and try to figure out what's going on. So let's see how logs work. I'm going to go to the data tab, and I'm going to go to that to-do item database that we were dealing with. And I didn't talk. We skipped right over to permissions real quickly, but let's talk a little bit about the data tab. When you actually look at a table, the first thing you can see are the records in the database. You'll see 16 is gone because I deleted it. Record ID 15 still there because I didn't have the right application key and I could not delete it. And you'll see it has the text in this complete. Now, if you look over here to the right, you'll see this created at. Now, let's go back to Fiddler. Now I have to copy up my application key again. So let's go manage keys one more time. Oops, too far. I'm going to get that application key one more time. And let's insert an item again. I think it was this. So here's another cool thing about Composer. So let's say you've captured the traffic from your app and then you want to re-execute something. In Fiddler, you can click on that trace. So you've taken this trace, right-click on it and say replay, reissue from Composer. You know, automatically put focus on the Composer tab and construct that URL and, in this case, post, so we have some body here. And I'm going to insert a new item. And then I have to put that Exumo application. Oh, no, I don't, because remember, inserts don't have it, don't require that. And we're going to hit execute. And I get a 400 back, which says it's a bad request. So it didn't like something about the request. Let's go back there again. The composer, I'm sorry. So it doesn't like something about this. Let's try taking out the content length. Let's try hitting execute again. We're still getting a bad request. So something is evil. It doesn't like something about this particular request. Well, at first glance, this is really puzzling, right? Because we just copied it from over here. And we right-clicked, and we said, replay, reissue from composer. We know this one's successful, or at least it was in the past, right? So what caused it to fail this time? So you know what? Let's not modify anything and just hit execute and see what happens. Huh, so this one succeeded. As you can see, we get that 201 back, and it returned in my JSON, returned that item. So we have this 400 that failed, and we have the 201, which is correct, and they're virtually identical. There's a feature in Fiddler, I don't think I have it set up, where you can click on both of those and hit compare and use something like WinDiff. No, I don't have WinDiff set up. But it'll actually compare these two and allow you to see what's different between them two. These two. Again, a very powerful tool for troubleshooting. You can take a look at a request that's successful, one that's failed, and try to figure out what's going on. So let's just do it by inspection first. So let's click on this thing, and we see that, let's go to the raw view. And we see this coming through, content length 42. We see the object that I added. And let's take a look at the successful one. Content length's a little bit different, but other than that, it's the same. So we don't have a good clue here other than that it's different text that we've added here. So let's jump over to our management portal. And again, I said if there's an error, we'll hit the logs tab. So let's click on logs. So in this case, there's no errors. Well, here's where it's interesting, because actually a 400 is a valid response in HTTP. It just means you submitted something badly. Let's go back to the to-do item database again. And I've been hiding something from you, and that's the script tab here. So we have the ability, whenever we do any of these operations, any of the CRUD operations, create, update, insert, update, read, or delete, we have the ability to script. And by default, the scripts are very simple. Let me show you the delete. All it does is call this request execute. So here's where the real power of mobile services lie, are in these back-end scripts. Let's go back to the insert script and see what's going on. Well, in this case, in the insert, you see it's not the default script. I have a question. Let me get here. These operations are similar in concept to database triggers. Similar, yes. It's actually an interception mechanism. So we'll get this before we store it to the database. That was another great question, Ryan. The thing that actually executes the request and forwards it off to the database is this line here, request.execute. If you do not call that, whatever you've done won't happen in the back end. And that's exactly what we're doing in this insert script. So let's kind of dissect this a little bit. When we hit insert, we get this item thing. What that item thing is actually that JSON data that we passed. So let me bring up Fiddler again. So it's going to be this thing here. So it's going to say text from Jeff, complete and false. But it's going to look like an object, as you see in the bottom here, to our script. So it's going to be this object that has a completed member and a text member. It's not going to have an ID member yet, and I'll talk about that. So it'll have whatever I passed in, completed and text. And you could actually log that out. We could put in a console.log statement. And if we log item, it'll actually log that item as you see it. So it would be just like what we saw in Fiddler. So that's one way you can write to the console. Now, again, I said there was an error, but we didn't see anything in the log. So maybe that's a really good thing to do. Maybe what we should do is, if we meet this condition, do console a log. Actually, maybe console.warning would be even better. And that'll have a little asterisk. Or you could have a console.error, which will give you a little red symbol. We're going to say same thing. Text must be under 10. Or something like that. I'm going to type forever. But you notice what I'm doing here is I'm saying the item. So again, remember, that's that JSON object. We'll go back there real quick. So it's this thing. We're saying if the text item is length is greater than 10, we're going to respond with a status code bad request. That happens to be that 400 that we saw. But also look at this. I'm sending back a string. If I was really good with Fiddler, what I would have noticed immediately on my 400, if I click on it and then go to the raw view, is there's my text. It would have told me exactly what the problem was. So if you do refuse things with like something like a 400 bad request, make sure you put that information there. It doesn't mean everybody will catch it. I didn't catch it, at least in this demo I didn't. But at least it'll be there, and you'll learn after working with HTTP, if you're not used to it, that generally if you do get something like a bad request, they'll tell you, if it's a good programmer, they'll tell you what's wrong with that. So we can just stop right here. Let's go back to that script for a minute, though. I want to show you that how to log out, again, that item. So we'll do that. We'll do console log, and we'll just log the item itself. And then we have this warning that we added, and we'll hit save. Then we're going to go back to Fiddler. And we're going to create this 400 error again. So again, I'm going to right-click on it, reissue from Composer, hit execute. Interesting. Now we have a different error, a 500. If we click on that and hit raw, we're getting an error back that isn't very helpful. X power by root. Oh, that's funny. I'll answer your question in just a minute, Ryan. So let's see if we can figure out what's going on with this 500. This will be a good demo effect because I actually didn't expect any errors, so we'll just have to see what I did wrong. So again, I said if you go back and then hit logs, since it was a 500, oh, yeah. So I've clicked on the error. Again, this was an error that I didn't trap. This is coming from the scripting system. And if I hit the details down below, it's easier to see. And it tells you what is going on here. It says this object has no method warning. I think it's console.warn, actually, so that's probably why I got it wrong. But the other thing it does is show you the source. Let me see if I can get that over here. So I know it's coming from the insert script. And I know it's this warning thing. So even if I knew nothing about the scripting in here, I could very quickly go back to data, go to my to-do item, go script. It said it was the insert, and it said warning. If I search for warning, I say, oh, yeah, there it is right there. I may get this wrong again. I think, do I have the IntelliSense on? No. You know what? In the interest of time, we're just going to change it to log. I believe it's warn, but we'll leave that there and save. But the other item that I put into the The other item I put in was I console logged the item. So let's look at that in the logs. And you'll see it comes up as information. And actually, you'll see, like I promised, it's logging out that JSON object. So any questions on that basic part of the insert script and what's going on there, is that not clear to everybody, or does that raise some additional questions for you guys? All Okay, on to Ryan's question. He said, X Power BI reports ASP.NET, but you are using Node.js. Is it intentional to mislead potential attackers? Good question, and let me show you what he's talking about. You'll see we have this X powered by ASP.NET. Anything with an X in front of it is a generic non-standard message. And what he's saying is, hey, it says that your website is reporting back that it's powered by ASP.NET. So in reality, it's fronted by a service that passes off to Node.js. So it really is ASP.NET on the front end, and it's handing off to Node.js. So it's not a direct Node.js. That's why you see that there. So great, insightful question there, Ryan. So let's go back. Let's see if we fixed the problem as far as the logging goes. Because we just did some troubleshooting, and it said warning. Let's hit execute. We get the 400 back, but we expect that because if we hit raw, again, the text length must be under 10, and my text length is not. So if I shorten this, we'll go back to Composer. And execute. You'll see it succeeds. And I would expect that also to be logged. Let's drill into this just a little bit more. I want to take a look at the JSON that was created and point out a couple things. One is, when I sent this, here's the object I sent. I sent this object that says text is under and complete is false. So what this means is, for the text database column, or I'm going to create, since I'm doing a post, and in the text database column, insert this value under, in the complete database column, insert this data, which is false. And indeed, we see in the return, when it hands it back, now again, remember when we saw this thing come back, let's go to the headers view, it gives you this location, which points to the object, and then it's index 18. If I look at the JSON, you see this extra column added, which is the ID, which is 18. In mobile services, we always need an identity column, which is lowercase ID. 18 has to be identity, and it's auto-generated, so we'll cover that a little bit later. But that's where that comes from. But I don't know if you all caught this, but when we take a look at the data, there's this extra column. See this created at that shows up. I didn't send it, and as a matter of fact, the system doesn't report that back either. So how did I accomplish that? Now, by default, there's no magic here. It won't do anything you don't tell it to. But again, through the power of scripting, we're able to change some things. Remember how I said item is that item that you pass in? Well, this is a JavaScript object. So we said item.createdAt equals new date. Date will be right now. And then we call request execute. So what this is doing is dynamically adding a column to the database called createdAt. And then we're hitting request execute. And request execute, we'll use the item that we have and do that insert into the database. But what's more interesting maybe is then after the execute, I'm deleting the item.createdAt because that item is returned back to the user in that string, and they don't really need to know what the date time is or the date was created at, so I decide to get rid of it. Where this also would be useful is, let's say you were assigning user IDs, or you had a column where you had a user ID associated with a table or something like that, and you don't want that screaming across the wire in HTTPS traffic, you could do the same thing. You could delete that. Or if you had a limited view of the data and you just wanted to save bandwidth, you know, think of a mobile phone, for example. You have a 3G connection and you don't want to use up all your user's data on unnecessary database columns and the like. Here's where you also could remove those. And again, on the other scripts, these are the defaults. It'll just look like something request execute, which passes that request by. Now, on the read, actually, I'm doing something a little tricky. I have a blog on this. I don't think we have enough time to talk about this. But basically, when I read, I'm doing this here. Part of the power of having scripting in the back end is you can move all your logic to the back end, and you don't have to code your clients to do that. And I'll show you through Fiddler what I'm doing here and then correspond that to the default application that is created. So let's take item, I think we still have an item 15. Let's go to Composer. Go to item 15. And we're going to do a patch. Now, I talked about that. This is how you update things. So let's patch item 15. And let's set the completed flag to false. Now, you don't have to pass the entire structure. You don't have to pass text and completed. By default, actually, our classes do that. So that might be an optimization you might want to add to your code as well, is that if you do an update and it's a huge data structure and you're only updating a completed flag, maybe you want to write a custom call to do the patch with only this particular bit. So I'm going to set the completed to true on this. I've done everything right. The patch does the update, inch update item 15. I was double checking the database, make sure that's not already set. We'll see everything's set to false. Here's item 15, that is set to false too. Okay, very good. So let's execute this and see if we can successfully update item 15. We get that 401 unauthorized, because remember my update has that application key on there. I'm gonna just temporarily remove that. And after time I do have to delete too. Save our changes. And let's try this one more time. We're going to execute. Very good. We see this complete true. If we take a look, and this is the, I'm sorry, that's what we set. I got to double click on it. There we go. We see complete is set to true. And if I go back to the database, indeed, as you would expect, 15, we see this come back as true. Now, in the default application that gets generated, let's do that really quick because it's very easy to do. I hope you're all familiar with creating a mobile service. When you do that, you can create an existing store app, or it actually will generate, and it'll generate a project for you. You can actually just take code that it tells you and puts it into your application. I'm going to create a new Windows store app real quick here. I don't have to create the table because it already exists, the to-do item, but that's what you would do is if this is the first time in here. You hit download, and this will give you just a real quick application that will access that to-do item. Right-click on this, extract it, and then we will open this thing up. It's up in Visual Studio 2012. So this is what the system just generated for me. Whoa. There you go. And without drilling too much into this, I'll give you a very quick overview that it actually is documented on that website just where it came from. This is the thing, the object that connects to the mobile service you see in my name and that application key. So the magic behind this is whenever we make a call with a mobile service, it uses this information to make HTTPS REST call using the XZUMO application key of this. XZUMO application key won't be used if we use client authentication. We'll talk about that a little bit later. And then we use that client object. Whoop, scrolled too far. That's the update. We want the insert. There we go. We have this to-do table, which again is no magic here. So we're just saying we give you some classes in C#. And this is similar in all the platforms, whether it's iOS, Android, or even JavaScript. So that mobile service object that we have, we call get table, a to-do item, which actually doesn't do a HTTP get. It just gets you a reference to that table. And then when we did the insert, what this does is actually do exactly what we saw in Fiddler. It's going to create that HTTPS traffic and transmit it off to the mobile service. So what's interesting here is you'll see over here with refresh to-do items, we're applying a filter. So we're saying give us that to-do table, but we don't want the things that are marked complete. So don't return those. We only want the stuff that we have to do, if you will. And let's run the app real quick. Matter of fact, I'm going to turn on Fiddler. So down to the bottom side here again, we click to start the capturing. Let's run the application. Let me move it over here so you can see it. And we shouldn't see item 15 in here because of the filter. You see there isn't even 15 items, so there's something going on here. But the concept is when you say complete, we update, and we send that back. So we should be able to see this track in Fiddler. Let's see what's going on with Fiddler. I'm going to close this thing, bring Fiddler back into the picture, and you'll see we have some requests to Jeff training. I'm going to stop capturing. And so let's look, first of all, at this one. So I'm going to double-click on it. And over here you see we're doing a get on the table's to-do item, and then we're passing this filter. So here's where the OData comes in. Again, great troubleshooting step, right? If you know, try to hit your table's to-do item, and if that succeeds, maybe there's something weird going on in your application. You've messed up the filter, or you're applying a filter you didn't even realize. So maybe the first time you run the to-do app, you didn't realize that clicking those checkboxes automatically filters those out. It does that through this filter. This is documented, and we have this on our Azure site, so I'll send you some links with this as well. So that's the first thing to look at. Then you see in the JSON, like we got back before, you'll see a whole bunch of our records. And you see item 15 didn't come back because it's marked complete equals true. So why did I show you that traffic? Well, let's go back to the app again. Having to do this, especially if this is a complicated query, and especially if the fact is that you're always doing this, like I never want to see the completed items out of the to-do item anywhere in my application. So it doesn't make sense to have to put this in every single one of my applications that I develop, my Windows Store app, my phone app, my iOS app, my Android app. I just want to get the to-do item and get that. So this is actually what I've done inside the script to Jeff training. And I'll prove it to you as we take a look at it here. Oops, and it'll be on the read, right? Because that's what we're getting. Ignoring all this stuff at top, there's some gobbledygook in there. Basically, we're saying execute the query where complete is false. And here's even another thing. It says where created at is not equal to null. Because if you remember in my database, you had all those created at columns. I had added that at a later point in my development of my application. So I had some null columns for created at, and I didn't want to consider those at all. So idea here is that you can create complicated queries in the back end, and you don't have to duplicate that code in each one of your client applications. And then we call, remember I said you have to call execute for stuff to happen. And so we call in request execute. And I could have just done that, but I had another handler here. I said, if request executes okay, so we're able to read, basically is what that means, get the results. And for each one of those results, delete out that created at column. Because remember, I said there's that created at column that I didn't want to be returned. So this default, and then we call request respond to finalize this. You have to do that when you have this success handler. So in theory, if I haven't been lying to you, if I just do a read on the table and we hit this code path, that's exactly what should happen. I should get back only those results that are incomplete, and that created at column should not appear. So to prove that, let's go over to this, and we're going to revisit in Composer, replay in Composer, I'm sorry. We're going to take that filter off, because remember I said the filter is the thing that does the magic for that. And we're going to execute. Succeeded, and you'll see I don't get back that column for the when it was created. And also it's not returning item 15, which happens to be the one, there's actually a couple of them in there, that have completed set to true. So again, a real powerful mechanism for you to put all your logic in the back end, so it's very easy to create and test in the front end. I put together a fairly complicated application without writing any client code. I did everything using Fiddler and those back-end scripts to do post notifications, to create tables, to do lookups for user IDs, for authentication, all sorts of powerful things like that, and I didn't write a bit of the client code. I had the advantage of that I knew that I didn't have to worry about making mistakes in the client code because these are very simple APIs, and it also made me design my backend so it would be simple. So I had different views on tables, for example, that had different data coming back from it, which is part of what this insert or the read script is doing. So this read script talks about having parameters. So when you do any of these operations like read, you can actually pass parameters in the query, and I'm talking about URL parameters like you would just append onto a normal HTTPS request, and you can make a switch on there. So in this case, I had two separate operations. One was called no filters, and if no filters was passed in, I would call operation two, and notice it would just call request execute. It would never hit this path. So that was a way that I could get back all the items that had null for that created at column, and also would return the complete equals true columns as well. One more time, the concept being that 99.9% of the time, that's the view that I want, and I didn't want that code in my back end. Okay, Ryan has a good question. He says, I may have missed it, but is it possible to project access to different table-based and custom APIs independently? So can you unmute Ryan and talk about what you're talking about with the projection? Or
sure. My question is related to, if I have, say, like three different tables and I've added a custom API as well, can I protect all four of those things with different roles or layers of security or whatnot independent of one another? Or is there like the same security scheme used across the entire thing?
It's per table. So okay. Now, that brings up another great question, however. So I let me try to rephrase that a little bit for you and see if this would fit into what you're talking about. Let's say by default I've created this view, this read view, the to-do item table that always returns back, you know, completed is false and created at is null or not equal to null. That gives me that view. But in another script, I don't want that. I want the default view of all of the tables. Is that pretty close to what you're asking, Ryan?
Yes.
Okay. So the answer is yes. There's a way to bypass this script. Now, you only want to do it from the back end. The way to bypass the script, actually, is you can say no script on a parameter, and you need something called the application, the master key out of the mobile surface itself. That's this thing, this master key. With this master key, you can do anything. As far as accessing tables, you don't have to worry about authentication. You can bypass the scripts. Extremely powerful, but has the same restrictions as application key. If you pass this master key in your application or it's stored with your application, people can grab it. So only use the master key from another script. So you can access other tables from your scripts. So let's say, for example, in this test one, and on the read, I wanted to get another table. I can actually go to get table. I can't remember the exact syntax. It's been too long. Get table. I could get whatever that table is, and I could execute that by passing the master key, and I could do that also from an API script, and that would bypass that insert. Or I could use parameters like I showed you in this to-do items thing. So there's a couple different ways to get around that. And we'll talk about database views as well. So could I have a standard set of user tables APIs and admin tables and APIs in the same mobile service? Yes, you definitely could. You definitely could. And they could even point to the same source. So you can get pretty powerful on this. So probably a good idea to start talking about user authentication, because that's one way that you could do this. But I want to pause and see if anybody has any questions about the scripting in general, whether it be the insert scripts themselves or what I've done here, just to get it clear in your mind, or if there's any other way I can make it more clear, if you have additional questions about this.
The only other question I have on this, if I can ask one more question, is the typical or recommended way of testing these just to use something like Fiddler, or do you have another way to hook into these scripts to test functionality before you deploy them in or go and update the mobile servers directly?
So that's an awesome question. So it points to two possible solutions. Most of the time what I've seen and what I've done for myself is to have another mobile service. So, for example, this one's called Jeff Training. So I'd have a Jeff Training test or Jeff Training UAT, which would be basically a duplication of my mobile service as far as scripts go, and use that to test things. That's not always the easiest thing to do for people, and sometimes you get confused, but actually using source control and the command line tools, and again, we have some documentation on this that Josh, I think it's Josh Twist, had done, and I'll send you these links. But basically, you can do command line to, you know, after you're done with your testing, just deploy those same exact scripts off into your mobile service, and so you could automate all this, for example. But as far as the testing itself goes, we do have a blog on this. And again, I think Josh Twist did this one. Since this, the background of this thing is Node.js, you can use Node.js and mock, bring all this stuff local, mock up your table, so put in your dummy data that you want to test, and actually just run these scripts through Node.js in the command line and see what the results are. That's a pretty powerful thing. Now, I had some troubles doing the debugging with the default tools with this, because what I want to be able to do is actually walk through the scripts, and I get kind of frustrated and ended up not being able to do it. Apparently, it works very well on Apple, but there are some problems on our side. So I'd never pursued it further. It didn't seem to be that important, or nobody had asked me further about that either. But if that's something you would want to do, you know, definitely let us know and just pop a little thing in the forum, say, hey, I really want to get this thing to work, and we'll respond to that. So this is two different ways to do testing. I like the idea of the UAT side of things, or the test mobile service, just because of the fact that it's the actual environment, right? So if there's something subtly different between our Node.js objects and the ones that you bring down, will be reflected, you know, in that test mobile services. So that's what I would recommend, but I understand there's different ways to do that. So another way, I was going to say this to a little bit towards the end, but with Visual Studio Ultimate 2.13, this is a release candidate which is publicly available. I think it's publicly available if you have MSD in the description. You can actually connect to your mobile service, which is huge. If you noticed me fumbling around trying to do typing in the script editor, that was fine for a couple lines. But if it gets complicated, you can use this feature instead. So I've already set up the access to the Azure service. It's fairly simple. You right-click on it, you import subscriptions, and it has a wizard that walks you through logging in to your subscription and automatically importing and setting up the connections in Visual Studio for you. And once you do that, you can see what you have. So I have a mobile service and a website. Under mobile services, we were just looking at Jeff Training. So if I click on that, you'll see I have my data. And then inside there, and now when I say data, the representation of the tables and their scripts. You won't browse stuff here, actually. And each of my scripts. So we were talking about the read script. If I click on that, yay, we can edit this thing in Visual Studio. And when we're done with it, we just hit this little save button. It saves it up there, and we have our changes. So this is a fantastic way to work with these scripts, especially as they get complicated. With that in mind, a poor man's testing environment would be to copy and paste this from your test over to your functional one. So that's another option there. And while we're here, let me see how we're doing that time. We're getting a little tight on time, so I won't take a whole lot of time. But you can actually read in one of your projects. See, we just did Jeff Training one, right? So let's load that. Getting click happy here. File, open, project. Did I save that? Yes, I did. Can open up my Jeff Training project. Remember, I did nothing. I just basically downloaded that from retarget to Windows 8.1. We're going to retarget this thing to Windows 8.1. Right-click, retarget to 8.1. So there's a little quick lesson in Windows Store apps, how to retarget your applications. Say OK. And then there's this, if you have a complicated app, there, this migrate document will give you some further tips, and you should read that. I know that there's nothing in my project that is affected by this, so I'll just kind of cancel. And now this is Windows 8.1 Store app. And if I right-click on it again, I can go to Add. I get push notifications to my application. It's very simple to do, and we document how to do this, but now it's all built into a wizard. And so we'll walk through it real quick. If you're not signed into your developer account, it'll prompt you to. And so I want to do push notifications and let's attach it to the Jeff Sanders auth. So another thing I could do is, let's do a new app name. So it'll be Jeff Chalk Talk. So behind the scenes, what this is doing is accessing the Windows Store. Didn't allow me to reserve that. I'm not going to debug this right now. There might be one already with this name, but let's associate it with this one. And this does several things. One thing it does is configure your mobile service. And so I have to pick the mobile service. So again, we were in Jeff Training. And this tells you what it does. Basically, it adds reference to the mobile services SDK, initializes the project, updates the mobile service itself with what we need to do the push notifications, and actually a script, when I'm done, will send that toast notification. So, fortunately, I didn't build my app first, so we probably won't get that script push notification, but we'll do it anyhow. We'll see if we get a push notification or not. No, I would have had to build it before. So I'll take a big risk. I didn't practice beforehand, but let's run the application and see if we get the push notifications. And got the insert. Yeah, demo effect. I didn't get the push notification, unfortunately. It is that easy. I've done it before, but I have actually some weird connection things going on here on my machine, so that's why I was kind of suspect that I may not do it. So again, making it a lot easier to do that sort of thing, at least for a Windows Store app. It doesn't do anything that we don't document. It just kind of encapsulates a wizard, which is really nice. The code it inserts, you'll see that it changed my Jeff Training insert code, so this is actually what we would see in the browser as well, and it added all this stuff. So it added, it did a get table and a channels table. Well, that might be it. I might not have the channels table. And then does send the notification off there. Do I see anything off the top of my head? No, I don't see a reason why that would fail. What we can do, let's just take a quick look at Jeff Training and see if maybe if it logs something in there. So let's go to the dashboard. And so the mobile service is called Jeff Training. And it would have done, first of all, it would have set the identity for Microsoft accounts in here. That's what failed. Okay, so that's why I didn't get the push. I will debug that later and make sure it's working for you guys by the time you get it. The second thing we can take a look is the logs and see if it logged any errors. Yeah. And you'll see that we did get the insert, so push me worked, but you see this error here in the table channels insert.js. If we hit details, it even tells me, which I already looked at, that the client ID and the client secret was not set. And that would have been in the identity tab. So that's where this all, if you notice, I had an error when I actually did that. And so that's what the error was, is it was not able to write these two values in here. Now, this brings up another good troubleshooting step. We're not totally sure why, but every now and then when you make some of these changes, it does not reset your mobile service. So Give me an example, another example why you might want to reset your mobile service. Let's say you're getting some sort of weird scripting error that you fixed, but it hung your service and you just can't get to it. You're getting like a 500 error back. One thing you can try real quick is you can go to the configure and you can toggle this dynamic schema on, or the opposite if you have it on. Hit save and then put it back to its original settings. And hit save. And that'll actually reload the virtual machine or your virtual website. So it's kind of like a last-ditch effort if you're getting some sort of weird 500 error. Or for some reason you've configured this identity and it doesn't seem, you know, you get that same error. You said, hey, I look here in Microsoft account settings is set, but for some reason it's that's what the error is saying, is that it isn't set. So that's one thing you could do to make sure that gets loaded. It's happened very rarely. But I have seen that once or twice, so that's kind of a cool tip there. Let me pause again. Let's see if I've generated some other questions. Okay, the very last thing I want to show you guys is how to connect to a different database. So again, using that knowledge that, you know, basically the mobile service just talks to a back-end database, how can I create a mobile service to hit my existing database? Of course, you know, you could create the to-do item table or any table you wanted by going into your mobile service and going to, we'll use Jeff Training again. We'll hit Data tab, and we could create a table right here. So, oops, can't have a space. This would create the table in the database. You notice it has no columns, except for the identity. It does have a default column one. And you can add columns to this by simply making sure your dynamic schema is on and using Fiddler. So I can go into Jeff Training. We've already done an insert, I think, here. And we can replay this in Composer. And what did I call that table? Good question. No. Good table. There we go. There we go. That's what I expected, one single in. So I go to good table. And I can insert columns and create columns in my database. Remember how I said that JavaScript object, or the object inside of our script was a JavaScript object and it's dynamic, so I can add other columns to the database here. I can say, here is a new one, and assign it maybe to a float or something like that. Now remember, there isn't even a text incomplete in that database right now. So if I've done everything right, actually it's going to fail because by default the permissions are set to every application key, so let's change that. Pretty good. So again, by default, there's nothing in this except for the ID. Hit execute. Whoops. Bad request. So I did something wrong with my JSON. Let's take a look at that real quick.
You put a comma before the 9.9 instead of a colon.
Thank you. You rock, man. Ah. Now what am I missing? False, 9.9. There's a 1, comma. Is it not like my float? It should. Well, let me cheat real quick and quote this, and then we can talk about how that'll work, see if that does it. It's okay. Good table is the name of my table. Nope. All right, let's do one more thing. So I'm just going to do the same as this, and then I'll abandon this and then update you guys on what I did wrong. Reissue for Composer. I'm going to use the same JSON object we had before. All right, let's look at our logs real quick. And didn't log anything. I'm going to go to configure real quick. Aha! Oh, it used to return. Oh, wait a minute. I look at the raw view. Remember I said that 400, I missed it? I missed it again. It told me exactly what the problem was. Let me make this thing bigger. Help you, notepad. Bring it over. It says, could not save the item because it contains a column that's not in the table schema. By default, when you create a mobile service is created with what's called a dynamic schema. And what that means is I can insert ad hoc into the database any columns that I want, even though they're not specified in the database. So if I turn on the dynamic schema and save it, I shouldn't get that error message now. And then when I go back to the data for a good table, we should see that it does have those items. So let's do that. Let's re-execute this first one. So right-click, replay, reach from composer. Oh, it's got the comma in there again. Execute. That's looking better. So that did create it. And again, if I click on JSON, it shows me the object that was created. And let's look at the data in here. We'll refresh this by skipping over to a new table and back. You see it created the columns and the data's in there. So that's how you can construct your database. You know, you don't have to go into SQL Azure itself and mess with it. You can just do this dynamically. And then when it adds the columns, it figures out for you what things are. So new complete was a Boolean because it said false. Here's one is a number. And then finally text was a string. So questions about creating tables and or that dynamic schema that I showed you. Is that clear? Okay, what kind of got me on this track here is I wanted to show you real quickly how you could connect to a different database. So let's say I have an existing SQL Azure database that I want to connect to called Attached to Me from WAMS. So here's this database. And if I click on Design Your Database, I can log in. And I could see a bunch of tables in here. And let's say I had an existing table in here. So let's create a new table. And we'll just call it table one. We'll just leave the defaults, column one, column two, and ID here. And that's good enough for me. Maybe we'll insert some data too. Well, oh, one change you have to make sure is identity is checked. If you have an existing database and the ID column does not have this marked, I actually have a script that will tell you how to change that. So we have this existing table. It doesn't have any data in it yet. And I want to be able to access it from my mobile service. So back to administration. Overview. There we go. So again, remember I said the schema name result is what we use for a mobile service. So Jay Sanders attached to DB is the name of a mobile service. Well, I don't have a mobile service named DBO. So we're going to see how this plays out here. Let me click over real quick and see what the question was. All tables have to have an ID column marked as identity. So Ryan's question is, so is this a requirement that the ID column has to be an ID column and marked as identity? Either the table has to be, or you have to create a view on the database. I'll share a link with how to connect to an existing database through a view that will, matter of fact, let's do that. Okay, so by default that ID also has to be lowercase, I believe, but let's see if we can change it real quick. I think I can still change it because there's no data. So we're going to call it my ID. So it does have to be identity. And let's save that. There's no data. Whoops. Now I can probably say I can't change that identity. Yeah. Let's create a new table real quick. So again, the scenarios, we have an existing one. It has a different identity column. It's not called ID, for example. We'll save that. And it's called table 2. So I want to be able to attach to this table 2 from my mobile service. And again, the database that we're using is attached to me from WAMS. So we'll go back to mobile services. And I just did a Jeff is cool. I'm going to do a Jeff is cool 2. So we're going to create a new mobile service. And we're going to use an existing database in the East region. So here I was talking about the different regions you could pick. And the database I want to use is not listed because it's a different, let me go back. I have two different subscriptions. Try this again. And we're going to attach to the attached to me from WAMS database. Say dbAdmin and my password. And what this is going to do for me actually is set up a unique user for this mobile service in the database and allow me to connect to it. It hasn't created any tables yet though. So once this is done, sure, it's going to, there we go. So it created that. Again, the database that I attached to was, you can get to it through the dashboard if you want. Attach me from WAMS. And actually what I'll do is go in and I will do the default to-do item table. Just, it could be anything, but I'm just picking that as a an easy one for me. Because I know the structure that I want and I can do that very quickly. So remember I said that the schema has to be in there for the mobile service. So the very first thing I have to do is create a schema. Again, I'll give you links to, well actually there's a link to a blog that talks about this. So we're going to create a schema. And again, this is the name of the mobile service. We'll hit run. Whoops. There's already one there. Okay. If I hadn't created the mobile service first, I forgot that. When I created the mobile service and attached the database, it does create the Jeff is cool schema in there, so I don't have to create that. If I did this before I created the mobile service, I'd have to create the schema in there. And then what we want to do is we want to create a view on that existing data. So I have that table 2 in there. And it has my ID as a column. Let me type it over here, and then I'll transfer it over. And I'll paste it in there. Let's see, Jeff's cool too. So we're going to create a view called to-do item, and it's going to have select ID as my ID, because remember, that's the alias ID. In column 1, I can make it as text, for example, and column 2 as, I'm sorry, the other way around. Nope, I had it right the first time. This is backwards here. ID as ID, and then column 1 is going to be transferred to a column that we're going to call text. And then finally, column 2 will be that completed flag. Hit run. My ID. Let me double check this. Oh, table two, that's why. There we go. Very good. So now we've created a view on this database that should match the to-do item schema. And I should be able to call it now from Jeff's cool. And we can do that in Fiddler again. Oh, one other step we have to take is we have to let mobile services know about this database. Very simple to do. So we have our Jeff is cool to mobile service. And the data already exists, or the table already exists, but we have to tell mobile service about it. So you just say create table. And this is going to be actually the name of the view that I just created, so to do item. What this will do is this will wire up everything for that table. And just for giggles, I'm going to just set it to everyone so I don't have to mess with the application key. So you see it created the table. And it doesn't see any of the columns yet. Now, this is a side effect of how things get wired with SQL, but we'll see how this works in Fiddler. Go into Composer, and we're going to get to-do item. And the name of that is Jeff to School 2. And get rid of this. And this. So see if we can actually connect to this table. Remember, there's no data in it yet. So we're able to connect to it. So in theory, we should be able to also add data to it. So let's post. And we'll say text. In our familiar to-do item format, we'll try to post that in there. We have the 201, which says it was created. And so let's do two things. Let's just fetch that table again. So we'll reissue this request. I'm just going to reissue it from here. And you see we did get our data back. And then furthermore, if we go to actually to the database, the Azure database in the back end, we should see that information there too. So let's go back to design. Table 2, see the schema name is still there, but we have a view on this again. And let's look at the data itself. And you see there's our information. So real quickly, that's how I can connect to a different table in the same database, but is not assigned to the same schema. So example of that was I already have a SQL Azure database. I have lots of data in there, and I just want to be able to hit it from my mobile service. Here's how you can do it without having to copy or replicate data. Just make a view on this thing, and then the insert, update, delete, that'll just all work like magic on there. And notice also that the ID, you know, I didn't have to change the ID. I didn't have to change the name of the columns, and it can be reflected in my mobile service that way. So I've used a lot of your time. I'm going to make that my last bit of presentation, unless you guys have further questions and that I have something I can show you in that. So let me just open it up to general questions or questions about the database access. And if there are none, then we'll just call it a wrap. So please make sure you unmute yourself or type it in the IM window.
So I don't know if this question makes any sense. Is it possible to protect tables that you don't necessarily want to expose publicly? And by protect them, I don't necessarily mean by security, but like completely hide them. Or is that effectively what you were just sort of showing, sort of build it out in the back end yourself and don't expose it directly, expose it through a view or something to that effect?
Right. That's So in your backend Azure SQL database, that's under your control. You can do whatever you want in that backend database. And then access data and or more complicated, because, you know, with a view, you can do all sorts of weird joins and queries and all sorts of great stuff. Again, that concept is move all that logic into the backend so your client isn't doing that. But then, you know, it's up to you whether you even expose that through the mobile service. Now, if you're talking about the table itself, so say I have a mobile service table, whoops, and again, realize that that table didn't even though that view was in that schema, it did not even exist until I did a create table here. So unless I went in here and said create table and created that to-do item, it would not be, the mobile service wouldn't even know it existed. So you couldn't do, you know, tables slash guess the table name and all of a sudden you're into it. You wouldn't be able to do that. And then the last thing you can do is actually restrict it here to only scripts and admins. So okay, even if it was exposed, you could do this, and here's where you would use that master key. So that was actually a great question. Remember that master key I showed you guys? You could pass that, and that way that, you know, this table, you use the nice functions of mobile services to actually create the table, add columns, you know, you did this through Fiddler, for example, and now you want to lock this down, and you don't want anybody else to have access to this because it's that back-end table you're talking about. You just flip this little thing here, only scripts and admins, and it's not visible or accessible on the outside at all. So the exception being is if you use that master key, then you could actually go across. It's just a HTTPS REST call. That key would be passed. But again, hopefully, you know, it's inside our data center where you're going between this mobile service and maybe one of your mobile websites or something, or between two mobile services. So that would be totally hidden from the outside world. Make sense?
It does. Thank you.
Okay.
You didn't really touch on custom APIs, I don't remember.
I didn't. Kind of ran out of time, but briefly, custom APIs, you're able to define your own API, so call me. And you can call this again through the REST APIs, or we provide client libraries to be able to call these. And you have the same sort of permissions here for get, post, put, patch, and delete. And what those translate into are scripts for each one of these HTTP methods. So if I call this API and get, I can script in here. I can, and this actually tells you how to do it, which is pretty cool. I can go get the tables from my service, and with that table, for example, I could query it or do something like that, or I could access anything basically that I can access from within the scripts we saw in the insert, delete, update, and read. We can do that same thing here. And then there's two advantages to this. One is that you can call these API scripts and get back stuff other than JSON, which technically you could do with the other ones too, but we won't go into that depth right now. So we could return XML, for example, or we could return a web page. We could return anything as long as we can construct it in here with this call to the mobile service. And the other advantage is you can actually call these from your insert, update, read, and delete scripts. So if you have something common you want to do for every table on your insert, for all the tables within your mobile service, you could create a custom API and call that from here. It's fairly well documented. I think we've got all the big bugs worked out. Initially when it came out, there's troubles calling these scripts from the table scripts. There was a workaround published for that, but it wasn't, I mean, it was kind of hidden, so unless you went to the forums and searched for it, you wouldn't be successful calling these, but now that's all worked out. And the same thing applies here. If there are errors, it will be logged to the console, and you can do the console log here as well.
And since this is based on Node, is there any chance of Edge JS ever finding its way in here so we could do, for those who are familiar with .NET programming, be able to write C Sharp or PowerShell or Python or something for their service?
So I can say that the product team is keenly aware of people wanting to do .NET development for these scripts, and stay tuned for an announcement pretty soon on that. How's that for political?
That sounds good.
But to further answer your question, power users of Node.js know that you basically just have to load your code and you can call it from Node. That sounded cool. So what you can do actually is through Git, you have access to all the scripts in Node, and you could upload modules and your own custom code, and you could go kind of crazy with it. So the scenario you talked about, you could, I don't think there's anything preventing you from doing that today, but I would wait for the potential release of some sort of .NET framework that you could call instead.
I don't want to hog all the question and answer time, but I did have one more.
Sure.
This is kind of related to just competitors. So I know the one I'm most familiar with, just from reading about it, is Parse. What are kind of the marketing differences between Azure Mobile Services and something like Parse or one of the kind of mobile service only vendors?
Yeah, if I remember correctly, there's a lot of players now. So, and I briefly remember Parse. Some of them don't have the client library. So, you know, everything I showed you as far as doing the back end is very powerful, but ultimately you have to call it from something, right? So we provide examples and the starter code for iOS, Android, JavaScript, HTML, which opens up just about everything, right? REST API calls, and of course the Windows family, whether it be desktop, phone, or the Windows Store apps. So, you know, we have that. The other big thing is, hey, if you get in trouble, you create a support call and you get a hold of me or somebody on my team. And not to blow our own horn, but we give you guys great support and we'll help you resolve that. I'm not certain that a lot of these other outfits have that same level of support. The other thing is, too, is I think pretty much all of them have some sort of scaling, but with Azure scaling, you only pay for what you use. So let's say you have some sort of mobile service that gets hit really hard at Christmas, and the rest of the year, you know, it just trickles in. So you could scale this thing up to like, you know, 10 VM instances to handle that load, and you're only paying for them when they're running, and in your data API calls also are only affected if they're actually called. So you only get billed for what you're using, basically. So that's another real huge advantage. And then there's, it didn't talk about it because it's still coming out in preview, but we have the ability inside of each of our Azure services, specifically here we're talking about mobile services, is to have some auto scale things happen. So if you hit a certain threshold, you'll automatically scale my stuff up. Or always keep at the minimum, let's say 5, because I know that I'm always being hit hard and I don't want to pay that 30-second startup cost for the VM if I have to create a new one on demand. And that translates over to the database as well. You know, you get for free a certain amount of data, but, you know, you can easily scale that. And with the, you know, if you have your mobile service and your database in the same data center, you also are going to have very little to no perceptible lag between the accessing that REST API, the mobile service, and the actual database itself. So, I mean, you know, definitely things you have to consider when you are determining who you want to pick. Of course, you know, I work for Microsoft, so I want you to pick this one. I think it's really great. Just if you get into development and you start jumping in the forums, you'll notice too that myself and other people on my team, as well as the guys from the product team, are very active in monitoring the forums and getting user feedback. There's been a lot of changes that have been made because users said, hey, this is really nice, but I want to be able to do this. And at the top of the forums, we have a link inside there that says, hey, you know, log your request to user voice and let's vote this up. And if it's something that you guys really want, you know, we'll consider it. So hence the potential message about .NET that I was talking about. And they're very agile. They're constantly working and putting in new features and responding. Was that a good sales pitch? Any other questions, please feel free. Can I quote you? yeah, well, I don't think I said anything bad, so sure. let's talk about support a little bit. You do get support when you get developer support for Azure Mobile Services when you sign up for that, and I think it's $29 a month to basically that allows you to make a call and say, hey, you know, my service is down or something like that, and get support. But frankly, one way to get real quick response is to go to the Azure forums, the Azure Mobile Services forums, and you can get that through the support link. And you go to the online forums, MSDNs, I don't go to Stack Overflow just because I don't have time. But the MSDN Azure Mobile Services Forum is right here, and you'll see, you know, a lot of Microsoft guys in here, which are either product team or us support in answering these questions. So that would be my first thing, is hit that. If you get really stuck on something and for some reason I'm not responding in the forums, you know, you can drop me a line. I may tell you to go to the forums just because I'm really busy. Or I may say, gee, sorry, you know, you asked a question, we didn't get to it, and I'll either redirect you to somebody who can answer the question or something like that.